All right, everyone, welcome back to the Land of Kev. I am your host and the author. My name is Jeffrey Drum. Thank you all so much for joining me again. All right, everyone, welcome back. This is episode 136, and today I will be evaluating a newly published peer-reviewed research paper regarding the utilization of a hydraulic lift system during the construction of the Step Pyramid. If this is the type of content you're interested in regarding the ancient technology of a lost civilization utilizing physics and chemistry and the function of the Egyptian pyramids and other ancient structures from across the world, this is the channel for you. So please subscribe to the Land of Chem here on YouTube, and don't forget to click that little notification bell so that you do not miss the new episodes that premiere twice per week. Please like, comment, share, and stay tuned if you want to help support this channel and get access to exclusive research and unreleased footage that you will not see anywhere else. Check out the Land of Chem members only channel and thelandofchem.com if you want to pick up a copy of the book or grab some merch. Links in the video description below. If you want to follow me on Instagram, my handle is at thelandofchem. Also, don't forget, after you finish watching this video, please go subscribe to our two new channels here on YouTube, Egyptian Trash Cats for all you cat lovers out there, and Egypt Eats for food reviews. Ladies and gentlemen, as always, thank you all so much for the support. I think that is it for today's intro. So without further ado, let's get right to it. And just a quick reminder, the second 2024 Land of Chem Ancient Alchemy and Ascension Tour is on, and a few bookings are still available, but the deadline for reservations is coming up soon, and the time to make moves on this is now. So if you are interested in coming to Egypt to see the pyramids for yourself, including special permission access to Abu Sir and a private entry into all three chambers of the Great Pyramid of Giza at night during this epic adventure experience coming up in early winter later this year, please send me an email to contact@thelandofchem.com with the subject line Egypt Tour 3, and I will send you the full tour itinerary and pricing details. Thank you all so much, and I will see you soon here in the Land of Chem. All right, everyone, buckle your seatbelts for this intensive assessment, and here we go with tonight's episode. All right, by now, I'm sure most of you have heard about this new paper entitled On the Possible Use of Hydraulic Force to Assist with Building the Step Pyramid of Saqqara, that has been making its rounds within the Egyptology and academic communities, which has been peer-reviewed and published in a number of outlets for analysis from the scientific world. So that, ladies and gentlemen, is exactly what we are going to do today, starting with two points made in the abstract, and I will quote directly here. Quote, based on our mapping of the nearby watersheds, we show that one of the unexplained massive Saqqara structures, the Gizr el-Mudir enclosure, has the features of a check dam with the intent to trap sediment and water. The topography beyond the dam suggests a possible ephemeral lake west of the Djoser complex and water flow inside the quote-unquote dry moat surrounding it. In the southern section of the moat, we show that the monumental linear rock cut structure, consisting of successive deep compartments, combines the technical requirements of a water treatment facility, a settling basin, a retention basin, and a purification system. Together, the Gizr el-Mudir and the dry moat's inner south section work as a unified hydraulic system that improves water quality and regulates flow for practical purposes and human needs. End quote. Now, for any of you that have been following my work, some of this should already be sounding very familiar, as I propose that the great enclosure, Gizr el-Mudir, was a water treatment facility more than a year ago. But let's start with what they are proposing. So you can see here a figure showing the drainage area of Wadi Tafla, and these branches emanating from the Nile River that once flooded into this area. In another figure here, a bit closer, showing the Step Pyramid complex, including the quote-unquote dry moat that surrounds it, and the Gizr el-Mudir structure here, with these floodwaters feeding directly into the enclosure. Now, let's go back to 1 year ago in episode 86, entitled The Great Enclosure Gizr El Mudir, where I proposed the exact same thing. And all of the following slides are coming directly from that original episode, and I'll put a link in the video description below if you want to watch that video. In this one specifically, showing the branches emanating from the Nile River, feeding water directly into the great enclosure Gizr El Mudir. And I explained how the substantial size of the enclosure, measuring approximately 650 by 350 meters, and its walls are a massive 15 meters wide at their base. And you can see the thickness of the enclosure walls here from this Google satellite image, and how this design fits perfectly into the configuration of a water treatment facility. Now, one important detail, one of many, that this research team has completely ignored. They show here on their diagram that the water flows in this direction over the edge of the enclosure in what they call a quote-unquote check dam, with the water coming in this direction from the west. And they show that the enclosure itself is a completely enclosed rectangle. Well, all of the archaeological data shows that the southern side of the great enclosure has an open section, as you can see here. And this specific diagram coming from Cambridge University showing the same thing, the open overlapping area here on the southern side of the great enclosure. And another close-up Google satellite image, you can see the exact same thing on the southern side of the structure. And I proposed that the Nile branches fed water directly into this area on the southern side that was fitted with a series of sluice gates that allowed water into the great enclosure for water treatment. And I explained how various chemicals like ferric chloride facilitated the sediment coagulation, flocculation, and settling process. As stated here, flocculation is a process by which chemical coagulant added to the water acts to facilitate bonding between particles, creating larger aggregates which are easy to separate. This method is widely used in water treatment plants, a process that traces back to ancient chemical processes, as symbolized here, solve et coagula. Coagulation, of course, being one of the seven stages represented in these alchemical diagrams. So remember where you heard this idea first, presented here on the Land of Chem YouTube channel more than 1 year ago in episode 86, detailing the function of Gizr El Mudir, the great enclosure, as a water treatment facility. Next, let's move on to their statement about the quote-unquote dry moat functioning as a reservoir and a water source for their hydraulic lift system. And they show here that the quote-unquote dry moat was actually filled with water, and how these two shafts, labeled A and B, connected into the internal system, were also linked to this above-ground reservoir to feed water directly into this subterranean tunnel network. They also reference this same diagram that I have been presenting from the Latvian mission in 2007, showing the connection from the main chamber into the southern chamber. Well, once again, the idea that the quote-unquote dry moat is actually a water-filled reservoir that fed water into the subterranean system was also first presented here on the Land of Chem YouTube channel in episode 125, The Function of the Step Pyramid, several weeks ago before this article was ever made public. And I showed this exact same diagram showing the quote-unquote dry moat filled with water and functioning as a reservoir that fed water through the exact same shaft system that you can see here that they are referencing into the subterranean tunnel system. However, this function was not related to the construction of the pyramid, but rather in extracting and pumping of methane gas from the bedrock, as you can see here. with these 11 shafts operating as pumps to increase and reduce the internal pressure within the system to release the natural gas from the bedrock and pump it up into the upper chamber. Now, in their theory, they completely ignore the function or existence of these 11 shafts, as I will get to again in just a moment. Next, here you can see their proposal of this sequence of pits located on the southern side of the Step Pyramid Complex enclosure, with some old pictures here, and their subsequent explanation of how this component also functioned as a three-stage additional water purification system, which I actually agree with, as it works in conjunction with my original idea about the operation of the Gizr El Mudir water treatment facility. Next, on to their hypothesis about the internal hydraulic lift. As quoted directly here, begin quote, "We identified that the Step Pyramid's internal architecture is consistent with a hydraulic elevation mechanism never reported before. These ancient architects likely raised the stone from the pyramid center in a volcano fashion using the sediment-free water from the dry moat's south section. Ancient Egyptians are famous for their pioneering and mastery of hydraulics through canals for irrigation purposes and barges to transport huge stones. This work opens up a new line of research, the use of hydraulic force to erect the massive structures built by pharaohs." End quote. Well, once again, this is an idea that I have also proposed here on the channel, specifically in episode 107, entitled Artificial Stone, Hydraulic Lifts, and the Osiris Shaft, discussing the vertical bedrock shafts on the Giza Plateau functioning as hydraulic lifts. So now, let's take a look at exactly what they are proposing. And I will quote directly here. "The substructure features at least 13 shafts, including two significantly sizable twin shafts located at the north and south of the complex, and an extensive and well-organized network of galleries descending up to 45 meters below ground. The north shaft is surrounded by four comb-shaped structures distributed on each side in an angled 90 degrees apart. GPR revealed that the twin shaft layouts are connected by a 200-meter-long tunnel. Moreover, at least two of the 12 shafts on the pyramid's east side are connected to the supposed eastern section of the quote-unquote dry moat by two 80-meter-long pipes." End quote. But as I stated before, they provide no explanation or acknowledgement whatsoever for the 11 vertical shafts and focus only on the two shafts that they propose are connected into the dry moat reservoir. And then this diagram here shows how they propose the system worked, with the red granite plugged containers in the southern shaft and northern shafts functioning as valve systems to release water, which has at least one major issue that will also be relevant to their hypothesis, specifically regarding the container in the main chamber. They completely ignore the archaeological data that states, quote, "The granite vault in the southern chamber is similar to the one in the pyramid, but it is much smaller, and its interior was covered in traces of green copper," end quote, indicating that this southern container was once lined with copper. As I presented in episode 96, copper-lined methane gas containers. And they don't mention this detail whatsoever regarding the copper lining in the southern container, which, in my opinion, is critical in understanding the function of these components. Now, here's their explanation of how these plugged containers work, and I will quote directly here. Begin quote, "When opened, such a plug system would have allowed the northern shaft to be filled with water from the deep trench, or in another scenario, from the dry moat's eastern section. The permeable surrounding filling would have permitted water discharge control from the four side tunnels. Then the water could only seep through the granite box's lower joints. This design would have prevented water from rushing through the system at high speed with pressure shocks, end quote. Implying that the water would seep in between the cracks at the bottom of the container, which are quote unquote mortarless. They are basing this entire theory on this single picture taken from below the container during the modern excavations in the early 2000s, because there is, quote, no visible mortar in the picture. It is also clear that they have never been inside of the step pyramid because they use zero original photos, and this area below the container is now completely inaccessible due to a new modern floor that was installed within the northern chamber. Furthermore, this area under the container was never even visible during the ancient exploration of the structure, as all of the internal rubble that once filled this rectangular chamber was removed during the modern excavations. Now, let me recap here so you can explain exactly what they were saying. The water would fill this area here, the lower portion of the chamber, and would seep in between these so-called, quote, mortarless, end quote, red granite blocks, with water filling the container. The upper part of the container is mortared, as you can see here in yellow, and there was a, quote, impermeable frontier applied to the top of the container, the plug being the only exception to this, quote unquote, impermeable frontier. The plug would then be removed, allowing water to flow out of the container up into the chamber that was then utilized in this hydraulic lift application. So for now, I will leave it at that without any further commentary, as there are a few more details to explain. Here, they have some fancy CGI images showing the removal of the plug block, a process that I actually agree with and have proposed before. And now, more specifics about their hydraulic lift proposal, and I will quote directly from the research paper here. Begin quote, "We have developed a simple numerical model of the hydraulic lift to study its water consumption and loading capacity. The model was kept as simple as possible to be easily checked and only intended to give relevant orders of magnitude. The hydraulic lift is modeled as a float loaded with stones to build the pyramid, and with a vertical extension to raise this material at the necessary level. To achieve greater heights, we hypothesize that the lift platform was blocked during the float descent using beams. This modification would have allowed the platform to reach higher altitudes by adding or unfolding an extension. You'll see this here in just a moment. For the top of the pyramid, the float could be conversely used as a counterweight when descending, pulling on ropes that would haul the platform after passing over pulleys above the shaft head. The beginning of the pyramid building was most probably performed using ramps, prolonging the path from the local quarry, possibly the dry moat. To provide an upper bound of water consumption, we modeled the pyramid building using the hydraulic lift from the first layer at ground level." They further go on here to describe the water consumption model. "On the other hand, through our research and calculations, we have determined that the Wadi Tafla catchment had the capacity to supply 4 to 54 millimeters cubed over 20 to 30 years of construction. Therefore, not enough when assuming only pessimistic values, but sufficient when assuming intermediate values, and 8 times enough water to meet this demand when assuming optimistic values. If further research demonstrates that the higher clay and silt content possibly present at that time shortly after the Green Sahara period probably led to increased runoff coefficients by a factor of 2 to 3 or even more, the resource would be increased by the same factor." Here they are describing the water supply being sufficient enough to run this hydraulic lift system. As a result, the hydraulic mechanism may have only been usable when sufficient water supply was available. So it may have only been used periodically. Other techniques, such as ramps and levees, were likely used to bring the stones from the quarries and adjust their positions around the lifting mechanism or when it was not in operation. So even according to their own paper, there are issues with their hypothesis in regard to the water supply during the reign of the Pharaoh Djoser, and that it would only be functional under certain water conditions. They also clearly state that, quote, it may have only been used periodically, end quote, and that other methods of construction would have had to been implemented along with this extremely complex internal hydraulic lift system. Now, they do include some exceptional calculations regarding the float materials, buoyancy, displacement, etc., that I will quote directly here. Begin quote, the device operated in Djoser's northern shaft, a 7 by 7 meter well. The float size is designed almost to fill the shaft laterally to prevent inclination caused by uneven loading during the loading or unloading stages. A float's square section of size 6.5 meters is used in the following analysis. The float is assumed to be made of wood, such as Lebanese cedar, a material commonly used in ancient Egypt, having a density of approximately 560 kilograms per meters cubed. The total loading capacity is computed, assuming that the buoyancy with P equals 1,000 kilograms per meter cubed, the water density, and H, the float height in meters, that holds the gravity force applied to the lift. Here are the following calculations, and they conclude, this corresponds to 18.6 tons per meter of float. Therefore, 55 to 90 tons can be elevated by a 3 meter thick or 5 meter thick float respectively. This weight corresponds to those of the largest blocks found in the pyramids of the Old Kingdom in Egypt. Here, they are mathematically proving that a 6.5 meter square float with the thickness of 3 to 5 meters made of Lebanese cedar could be used to float 55 to 90 tons with the respect to the different thicknesses, which I find to be very interesting and a critical detail revealing the truth about the buoyancy and functionality of Lebanese cedar. You cannot argue with solid peer-reviewed math, and it outright proves that wood can float stone. So, with that being said, here is a diagram of their proposed hydraulic lift system. Starting here on the left, you can see that the plug valve is closed and the float is in its lowered position. On the next image, the plug is removed, allowing water to fill the chamber, raising the float. In the next two images, you can see that the proposed hydraulic lift mechanism has a series of unfolding elements and supports that allow the float, scaffolding, and load to be raised into the upper part of the construction, as you can see here in the final image on the right. And at the top of the lift, the stones are then offloaded using the previously specified methods in what they call a quote-unquote volcano construction, end quote, and then set into place within the body of the pyramid. Now, at this point, I am not going to offer my personal opinion on this hydraulic lift mechanism or process, as most importantly, I think it is crucial to propose new ideas about the construction of the Egyptian pyramids, with the bigger problem being individuals who do not have the courage to propose new ideas and instead hide behind clickbait nomenclature like quote-unquote lost ancient high technology, end quote. Now, there are a few interesting ideas that they point out in this paper that I want to share before I make my closing remarks. And I will quote directly again from the paper here. Begin quote, as authentic sources from the working sphere of pyramid architects are currently lacking, no generally accepted holistic model for pyramid construction exists yet. Although many detailed publications dedicated to pyramid building procedures have given tangible elements, they usually explain more recent, better documented, but also smaller pyramids. These techniques could include ramps, cranes, winches, toggle lifts, hoists, pivots, or a combination of them all. Studies of the pyramid's construction sites also reveal a high level of expertise in managing the hydraulic and hydrological environment, such as utilizing waterways to deliver materials, constructing ports and locks, or setting up irrigation systems. These achievements had led some scholars to refer to ancient Egypt as an early hydraulic civilization. However, there is actually very little multidisciplinary analysis combining the rich archaeological findings on pyramids with other disciplines such as hydrology, hydraulics, geotechnics, paleoclimatology, or civil engineering. Therefore, the topic of water force in the context of pyramid construction remains insufficiently addressed in the academic literature. And I 100% agree with this statement, as I believe and have proposed numerous times within the context of my work that the civilization that built the Egyptian pyramids were masters of hydraulics and would have utilized water not only in the construction, but also, and more importantly, in the operation of these structures. Next, I will quote here regarding the trench system with a statement that applies generally to all of the Egyptian pyramids and ancient structures across the world. Begin quote. Generally, two leading theories are highlighted in the literature to explain the purpose of the trench. One being a quarry for the Djoser complex or a spiritual function. However, over recent years, authors have pointed out several specificities in the trench's architectural layout, which seems irrelevant in a religious or mining context. On the spiritual aspect, this researcher suggests that the trench may have developed a ritual significance as a gathering place for the souls of the nobles to serve the dead king. Monnier considers that the discovery of several niches in this channel does not fully demonstrate the moat's religious purpose and considers it secondary. The trench's quote-unquote ritual significance is also regarded as secondary by Reader, who suggests that the ritual aspects developed only after the complex's construction and do not reflect the original function of the structure, end quote. Which now brings me to several final concluding statements. First, there are several functional ideas in this paper that I have proposed here on the land of Kem, namely the operation of Gizr el Mudir, the Great Enclosure, as a water treatment facility in episode 86, more than a year ago, and the quote-unquote dry moat being a water-filled reservoir that delivered water into the subterranean tunnel network recently in episode 125, The Function of the Step Pyramid. I also hypothesized that the function of the shafts on the Giza Plateau may have been for hydraulic lifts, way before this paper ever came out, although my conceptualization of the hydraulic lift system is far different than what they have presented here, and not necessarily a relevant topic for me here on the channel, as I focus mainly on the function of these structures and not the construction. But I do find it interesting that this academic work has corroborated my original hypotheses for the function of the Gizzer El Mudir Great Enclosure and the quote-unquote dry moat reservoir. And I can't help but wonder where they heard these ideas first. Next, a question that was proposed by my wife, Alexa, from Ancient Odysseys. So the intent of this entire paper is to investigate the genesis of pyramid building using hydraulic lifts, starting with the oldest pyramid construction, the Step Pyramid. But if this is how they did it, why don't we see this exact same configuration in the internal structure of all the other pyramids? Good point. And lastly, and maybe most importantly, generally speaking, as mentioned here, I think that they are misinterpreting and misunderstanding functional components of the structure that were utilized during its operation. For example, as I have proposed in episode 125, the function of the Step Pyramid, and misattributing these components to aspects of the construction. So overall, there are certainly some glaring archaeological research oversights that have been completely disregarded in this paper. But they do propose some ideas, many of which are also mine as originally presented here, that I think are very interesting and could be relevant to other functional features, such as the vertical shafts on the Giza Plateau. But let me know what you think in the comment section below, and I will put links to all of my original work, episode 86, episode 96, and episode 125, and links to this research paper if you want to read the whole thing in the video description below. All right, everyone, that is it for today's video. This was episode 136, the Step Pyramid Hydraulic Lift System. I really hope you enjoyed today's video, and in this week's Sunday site visit, the most epic expedition to the Giza Plateau that I have presented thus far. This is an episode you do not want to miss, so if you haven't already, please subscribe to The Land of Chem here on YouTube if you're interested in the ancient technology of a lost civilization utilizing physics and chemistry and the function of the Egyptian pyramids and other ancient structures from across the world. Don't forget to click that little notification bell, like, comment, and stay tuned. If you want to help support this channel and get access to exclusive research and unreleased footage, check out the Land of Chem members only channel and thelandofchem.com if you want to pick up a copy of the book or grab some merch. If you want to follow me on Instagram, my handle is at thelandofchem. Also, don't forget, after you finish watching this video, please go subscribe to our two new channels here on YouTube, Egyptian Trash Cats, for all you cat lovers out there, and Egypt Eats for Food Reviews. Links to everything in the video description below. Ladies and gentlemen, as always, thank you all so much for the support. I think that is it for today's episode. I will see you. Next time.
Yo, are you still watching this? Please subscribe to The Land of Chem here on YouTube and click that little notification button. New videos coming out every single week. And check out this other episode. Come on, do it. Do it now.